When I was about sort of 6 or 7, my mum had this little mantra if I got into trouble. And she used to say, "Do you know what happens every time you tell a lie?" "Huh? Do you know?" "No." "Every time you tell a lie, a fairy dies." Have you ever seen a fairy? Seriously. Say in the last 2 years. Ever seen a fairy? No. No, you haven't. And that is because every time Jack Straw opens his mouth, he kills the fuckers. It is wholesale fairy slaughter. It is fucking Dingley Dell Holocaust. There are fucking fairyland in Chile. They're trying to extradite Straw. And Jack Straw just loves a scapegoat, doesn't he? He loves it. It's a squeegee emergence. It's a bogus asylum seeker, aggressive beggars, Hampstead liberals, dole cheats, single mums. He's going to run out of scapegoats pretty soon. 3 weeks from now, he'll be tearing round the fucking commons. "The Vikings are coming!" And the amazing thing is, you look at what he said in opposition, right? He was against privatised prisons. He was for an effective Freedom of Information Act. He was for reform of the Official Secrets Act. He was against asylum seekers having their dole taken away. And you just say, everything, he's just... He was for... trial by jury. Everything. U-turns. Maureen from driving school is going, wow. And Jack's, the show tonight is about Uncle Jack. You've got Pinochet. Right, Pinochet. And I know some people go, "Oh, well, no, General Pinochet is too old." No, he's very, very old. And too old to stand trial. You see, I know people think he's too old, but that's not an excuse, is it? Just because he's got a fucking bus pass doesn't make him innocent. And Jack Straw said, "No, we have to release him. I'm minded to release him because he's very poorly. He's too ill to stand trial." And he might be too ill. You just think, why these court records, the medical records, why can't the lawyers working for Amnesty see them so they can assess them to see if they're fair? Because the person who's made the decision is Jack Straw, and we might not trust you. I want to find out for myself. I want to do a medical check on him myself to see if he's fit enough to stand trial. So he went down to Wentworth, where he's residing at the moment. And Wentworth's quite near because his house backs onto the golf course. And we thought of a scam to try and get to his door. And we thought, right, let's send the camera crew down. And about a minute later, I wandered into view. Have you seen a ball? Are you sure? I think I've chipped one of the things into here. Who's in it? This is the Pinochet thing, isn't it? Yeah? And he's in the garden. Can I go around and get me ball? I'll just knock on the door. "No, sir, you can't do that, sir. You can't. I just want me ball back. Pinochet's got me ball. I want me ball." If Pinochet's nicked me ball, I'll be furious. And I know he'll be taking it back to bloody Chile with him when he goes, won't he? It's absolutely bloody outrageous. He comes over here, he nicks our hospital beds, he starts mucking around, and then what happens is suddenly he's nicked me golf ball. All I want is me ball back, and some bloody tin pot dictators just nicked me golf ball. I want me ball! Come on! And this guy starts coming round going, "You can't get in there, sir, you can't get..." "He's some tin pot dictator going to steal my ball." "Well, you'll have to play through, sir." We had this bit of a standoff. What was great, though, was at one point he goes, "Look, I'll try and find the ball for you. You give me your details and I'll get it back. I'll get the ball to you." "Well, he's going to nick it. He's going to take it to Chile. And if he's fit enough to bend over and pick it up, he's fit enough to stand trial." He said, what are your details?" "I am a British citizen." "No, your name and address."
"I am Mr. Tarbuck.
Mr. Tarbuck.
Now, what I'd like is my ball back."
"Just generally speaking, I just want to know your opinions. Just to go, do you think Americans stupid?"
"Yes!"
"No, I kind of agree with you, they're a bit stupid. But there are some brilliant things in America.
sweets with peanut butter in, cheap CDs, and non-standardised leg waist measurement jeans. Fucking handy for me. The other thing they've got is a Freedom of Information Act, which is second to none. Right, if basically, if American officials write stuff down, you've got a chance of getting it. It's brilliant. I mean, they can get phone logs, they can get messages, they can get memos, they can get ministers' diaries, politicians' diaries, civil servants' diaries, they can get agendas, they can get minutes of meetings. And this recently, I just want to show you this. This recently came out from the CIA. It was released last year, and it relates to Pinochet. And the CIA released this last year under American Freedom of Information. This is what it said. It's firm and continuing policy that Allende be overthrown by a coup. There's another one here that just says, this relates to Santiago, to Chile, to the coup that put Pinochet in place. Submachine guns and ammo being sent by regular courier. DHL, I don't know. Parcel force. And it goes to Santiago, and you think, well, we all kind of know that Chile was, you know, that America backed the coup in Chile and put Pinochet in place. But in America, they can get the bits of paper and hold them up to their government and say, look, you yourselves admit you are murdering fucking scumbags. And that's a very good thing. Can you imagine going into MI5, MI6 in this country? Hello, I'd like all the documents about British-backed coups. I'm glad you've asked. I'll go and get that, sir. I've got some saucy pictures of the Prince Philip. Would you like to see them as well? In America, under Freedom of Information, we got the next documents, which you've got a sneak preview of. We got these documents under Freedom of Information in America. It's a telegram to the US ambassador in Britain, and it gives contents of a cabinet meeting. And this is what it says. It says, we understand that the cabinet may take up the issue at its Thursday, June 4th meeting. They know what's happening in a cabinet meeting that is yet to take place. They know that. Under American Freedom of Information, the Americans know what's being discussed in our cabinet meetings, June 4th. We don't know. They fucking do. Because we haven't got a Freedom of Information, we can't find out what's happening within our own government and civil servants. And I would like to just say, if there are any people who work in government departments watching the show, I'd just like to broadcast a subliminal message to you, just if you wouldn't mind. Did you think I got away with that? Was it subliminal enough? And that's what we needed. We need a Freedom of Information Bill in this country. Jack Straw is the man in charge of Freedom of Information. There are so many exemptions under the bill, not yet made an act. It's incredible. They're sort of like, no, you can't find out that because it's military. You can't find out as a public thing. You can't find out about that because it's policy and advice. You can't find out, I don't like you. In fact, you can find out less under Jack's Freedom of Information than you can now under the Tories' open code of voluntary access to government documents. Our documents. Because Jack Straw knows information is power. It's not easy. You see, had I known that was happening, I could have warned him. See? Information is power. Then we found out about this other plan. In fact, what we did in America, under Freedom of Information, we got documents that show that John Prescott's been lobbying the Secretary of State for Transport in America about slots at Denver Airport for BA, British Airways. Right now, there could be nothing wrong with that. That could be perfectly fine. He could be batting for Britain. Or he could be doing something slightly less valiant. We don't know. He might be favouring people. Does he do it for Virgin? Does he do it for British Midlands? Or is he just, you know, supporting people who've backed that fucking huge tent? I don't know. And we wanted to ask John. There is. This is what he said. I would be most grateful if you could now authorise the immediate commencement of the BA Denver service. Stern words, John. Now, in our helpful way, we wanted to see John Prescott to get the full story. So we go down to the Labour Party meeting where the Tony Blair and John Prescott are speaking in Southall, basically saying Ken Livingstone is the devil. So we get down there. It's all being held in a school. They've barricaded the place up. They've locked all the doors. They said no more press allowed. BBC journalists are being kicked away. But we have a cunning plan. And we've got a few Jaguar cars. And we've got the drivers in there with little caps. And they'd all got a sign saying, Mr. Prescott, in the front window. And we drove them at the security gate about 5 minutes before the meeting ended. And we sent the first batch went in, three of them, and the police opened the gates and let them in. Hold on. Can we just stop this? Just play it back a second, right? Because you can hear a copper saying, hang on, there's something going on here. Just, if you're really quiet, you'll hear it. Just can we play it?
Something going wrong here.
I don't know how many we got in. We reckon about 14. Says we reckon about 14 Jags got in there. And we were talking to the drivers, and they just said, it was great when we got in. They said, we're just all parked up next to Prescott's one and formed a nice long line. And the next stage of the plan was that they would all get up and stand by the exit with the signs and just wait. And I've just got, you fucking hell. So, John, if you are watching, we have got some of the documents. I'm not going to tell you which ones we've got. So why don't you just send us all of them and then we can have a look? Basically, Jack's found another scapegoat. Uncle Jack Straw has found another one. And what happened is, this is the case that's been called the Cambridge Two. Some of you might be aware of it. What happened, there was a, there's a homeless hostel in Cambridge called Winter Comfort. And two of the people who work there, Ruth Weiner and John Brock, they were, their job is to get homeless people off the street. The police are concerned because between 20 to 40% of homeless people in the Cambridge area have got drug problems. There's a lot of smackies going out there. Now, the police said, we want to catch the dealers. Ruth and John cooperated, saying, yeah, dealing's bad, we're going to try and sort something out. They run, the police ran, unbeknownst to Ruth and John, an undercover operation. Hundreds of hours of videotape was collected, and they eventually arrested eight dealers. They also arrested Ruth and John. They arrested them and charged them under Section 8 of the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971. And they were thinking, how can they do this? What's the charge against us? The charge was that Ruth and John hadn't made confidential notes available to the police that may have contained information about their suspicions of people who might be addicts. They were charged with Section 8. They were put on trial, and they got 5 years and 4 years in Nick Gospel for working in a homeless shelter with smack addicts and not giving the police their confidential notes. And they could have given it over, but they thought, this is so important, because if we turn around and say, we'll give you the notes, what does that do to homeless people? It just says, you come in here, we'll grass you up. Our job is to get them off the street. So they've gone to jail. And we spoke to the Labour MP from the area, and she is PPS to Patricia Hewitt, and so she's not going to say much. So we were fucking grateful when she said, it's a complete miscarriage of justice.
Well, I think there's a huge miscarriage of justice. I think that the judge who passed this sentence cannot possibly have understood the sort of circumstances under which John and Ruth were working. I've written to Jack Straw asking him to clarify and produce guidelines for people who are working in this sector. And I've also asked him, through a parliamentary question, if he intends to amend the Act, the 1971 Act, to make it clearer to people just what they can and can't do.
And we went up to Cambridge the other night and we talked to John Brock's family.
Yeah, it's really hard because you really look forward to the visit, you know, and you're really on a high, you're going to see him, you can cuddle and kiss him and it's great, you know, and then three quarters of an hour you've got to say goodbye and it's another 2 weeks before you can see him, and it's like a bereavement in a way.
Jack Straw, what do you want him to do?
I'd like him to reply to my son's letter. I've got a 10-year-old son as well, and he wrote to him on the 22nd of December, and we haven't had a reply. I'd like him to do that. I'd like him to read all the letters that my colleagues and friends and family have sent.
What did your 10-year-old write about in his letter?
He wrote about how his dad was doing his job, how his dad had been abused, he'd been threatened with a knife by the users, but had always stuck with his job. It'd be quite easy for him to have given up. And that he missed him, and he wished Jack Straw a happy Christmas and a happy millennium, but said he wasn't going to have one because his dad wasn't there.
And Jack hasn't got back to you yet?
No.
So, the other night, we went up to Cambridge, because this ruling and these sentences don't just affect people who work with the homeless. They affect anyone where drug dealing might take place. They affect teachers. They affect probation officers, prison officers, social workers, drug project workers. They can affect anyone. They could affect a church group. So we thought we'd go up to Cambridge.
Hiya. How you doing? Hiya. Hello, my name's Mark Thomas from Channel 4. We've got a group of people here who have just come to hand themselves in. I'm completely innocent, yeah. Okay?
That is untrue, as everybody who watches Channel 4 knows.
Hello there.
Hi, I'm Mark Thomas from Channel 4.
Good
pleased
to meet
you.
Mike Brown, Duty Inspector.
Excellent. What we've got here is these people here all work on homelessness projects, care projects, youth projects, or drug projects.
Right.
And after the Ruth and John the Cambridge 2 verdict, as you can see just behind you,
yep.
After that, they're very concerned that they haven't done everything within their power to prevent drug use taking place on the premises of which they have a managerial or a care role. And so they've come to hand themselves in.
Right.
And really, you should speak to them because they want to give themselves
sure,
up.
We've been reading the judgment, you know, the judge made, very serious about this, and I didn't know that what I was doing was a criminal activity. No, I didn't know that. I have absolute evidence that I broke the law. I spoke to this woman about a heroin addiction. She said he wasn't breaking the law, and it didn't come here until the police.
Right. I can only give my interpretation on it, yeah. In as far as the necessity for managers of hostels to do all in their power to ensure that the supply of drugs does not take place on their hostel premises.
And I have not.
No.
Definitely not. I plead guilty to it. I'm absolutely as charged.
Right. Well, what do you consider is in your power?
Well, I
that
could
you're
have done
doing?
All kinds of things. You know, sniffer dogs we should have used. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. X-ray machines. There's all kinds of them. We should have vetted everybody that came in to the building we had. There was a massive things we could have actually done, and we didn't, because we didn't know that was the law.
Yeah.
And I would demand to be arrested, right? I've broken the law, I'm pleading guilty to it, and the law is that I, and he's very clear on this, that's the second red pig thing, which is that I heard from the woman's own lips that she was a heroin addict, that she had taken heroin, she was breaking the law in a number of respects, and I did not immediately pick up my cell phone, come around the park side and say, excuse me, I just talked to a woman. Right. And I have to say that I demand for at least 600 offences similar to that to be taken into account. Because okay. I'm a social worker and I'm not a police informer. You have in front of you a guilty man.
If you're asking me to...
Show me the cells.
If you're asking me to explain the anomaly that you see here, I can't do that.
Yeah. I'm a felon. You know, I'm confessing.
Right. Okay. Well, with regard to what you're telling us, if you believe that you are in breach of the law, then I can take your details and I will have an officer come and speak to you and consider that point. It's my responsibility as a police officer, as I'm sure you're aware, to be impartial.
Yeah.
And to deal with the law as we see it.
Yeah.
And it's in dealing with the law as I see it that I will not be arresting you this afternoon. We do very much respect the work that you do.
Yeah.
Nobody is disputing that.
Yeah.
I know it's difficult. I appreciate that it is very difficult work that you do, and I also appreciate that this particular ruling is no doubt made all of you feel a lot less comfortable in your work than you were before.
Well, here we come. Everyone.
And so what we want people to do is basically to write to Jack Straw and to email Jack Straw and bombard him, fax him, everything. You know, throw paper darts at him if you see him. You know, just if you can find a window box and just write it in flowers, put it on the Home Office ledge, anything. We actually wanted to speak to Jack. In fact, we thought, no, we're not going to speak to Jack because we've seen Jack a couple of times. Me and Jack going, all right. I'm such a liar. But we did actually catch up with Jack, and we thought, how can we raise all these different issues, you know, about the terrorism bill that's going to go through that's going to make journalists criminals now? How can we do all of this? How can we deal with the immigration asylum? How can we deal with what he's doing to these people here? How can we deal with freedom of information? And we thought, let's try and sum it up in one kind of hit.
We're just here to offer our support. We're just here to offer our support, Mr. Straw, and applaud the work you've been doing. Very good on the trial by jury, very good on persecuting journalists, and very, very good on taking immigrants and asylum seekers' stuff away. Well done, Mr. Straw. We're just here offering you support, sir.
Thank you.
Well, so, we'll see you later. Pass it on to Jack that we're just here to give him our moral support and to make sure he keeps going on the same line. He could do with being a little less liberal. But if you could pass that on to Jack, that would be lovely. Thanks a lot.
Well, he suddenly got a phone call and somebody said, oh, Jack's going to be somewhere else. And I phoned up Steve Murray, who's Mussolini. What it was, we found out that Straw, we saw him on the Dimbleby show. And we just kind of like, quick, get the Hitler uniform, meet us outside the LWT offices, get down there now, get the crew, everything. It's just that we're big fans of Mr. Straw. We're just very, very big fans. We've got some rides. We're going to try and get his autograph as well.
Mr. Straw, these are for you. We're just big fans of your work.
Thank you very much.
We're big fans. We just
take it off. Just take the flag,
Jack.
We love you.
Oh, thank you.
Fantastic.
We're just big fans, Jack. We love your work. We love your work. We're big fans of yours.
Keep it up.
Although I recognise some of mine in yours. There's a little bit of plagiarism going on. But very good work. Can you give the flowers to Jack? Would you just tell him we're big fans? Thanks a lot. Cheers, Jack.
Keep it up, man.
Well, Poland or Ethiopia, your place or mine. Good night.
And you can talk to Mark live online now at chat.channel4.com.